On December 4th, 1967, PFC Charles Hagel arrived in Vietnam. He was assigned to the 9th Infantry Division, B Company. He was put on the line right away. He was only 21.
On the line meant that you were out in the bush. You were on ambush patrols or holding patrols. And that didn't mean that you were in combat all the time. Matter of fact, war is sometimes pretty boring. In fact, it may be the worst part of it, is the edge that you have knowing that at any moment anything can happen.
Thomas Hagel was only 19 when he volunteered to go to Vietnam. His older brother Chuck was already there, and when they asked to serve together, the Army said yes.
Frankly, I grew up with this idea that every generation had their war, and okay, this is our turn. And I think that's why so many people, certainly from the Midwest and us, went into it with that idea that, you know, it's our duty, our father did it, his generation, generation before that, and we went into it basically, at least I did, unquestionably.
Remember Lieutenant Mueller?
Yeah.
Remember he was from Iowa?
Yeah, regular guy.
Yeah, great guy. Remember he did that.
On August 14th, 1999, the Hagel brothers returned to Vietnam to visit the places where they fought together, where they were wounded together, and where they saw friends die.
Tom and I had served together at the worst time in the Vietnam War in 1968. And we had seen horrible things. We had been part of horrible, tragic, almost unexplainable events. I think you've got to start there.
The Hagel brothers and the men in their unit spent their time on patrol, always aware that the enemy could be anywhere. For them, it was a war of anxious uncertainty.
In a war like Vietnam, where it was a guerrilla war, where there were no rules, you would walk through a paddy field with Vietnamese women and children, letting your guard down. 4 or 5 days, life's been pretty good, nothing's happened, pretty quiet, and all of a sudden, the children or the women would be wired for booby traps, and they would sacrifice some kid. That constant pressure, that was that fear, and it was a very psychological process that the VC used, made a lot of guys just crazy. You never knew. You just never, ever knew.
The pressure, the heat, the jungle, and the Viet Cong came together in a deadly combination on March 28, 1968. On that day, Tom and Chuck were walking just yards from this spot.
This is what we're talking about the heat. This time of day, and this is not even totally surrounded by jungle, but this intense humid heat, and especially if you're carrying about 100 pounds of gear, you do it day after day after day, it wears you down a little bit.
They were on an ambush patrol at a place called Binh San in the jungle northeast of Saigon. Chuck and Tom had been walking point most of the day, but their commander rotated them to the back. Minutes later, the soldiers who replaced them on point tripped a booby trap, exploding mines full of shrapnel that were planted in the trees.
And Tom and I were next to each other when it happened. The first thing Tom did was he grabbed me and pulled me out of the water and then put bandages around my chest because I was bleeding pretty good.
And I instinctively turned around and he was on his back. I could see blood on the front of his shirt, and I tore his shirt open, and that's when like geysers of blood went out. And so I got out my bandage and wrapped him up think about it, it's bad enough wherever it would happen, but totally isolated. It was, the jungle was so thick, we had to take machetes and dig out a little area big enough for the medevacs. First of all, it took them a while to even find us, it was so thick, but they had to drop baskets out of the dusters to bring up the dead people and the wounded people.
If I recall, there were more than half the guys were wounded in that and killed. I mean, we had more than half our guys that were down from that when we got hit.
And the problem is it was too late to call in anybody.
So more than half of our that group got hit that day.
And then after all of that was over with, we were told that they could not extract us with helicopters because the jungle was too thick. And so that we'd have to walk out.
We started to walk out and I was on point. Tom was behind me and I walked, I don't know, maybe 10 yards and Tom yelled out at me and he said, stop, don't move. And I didn't see it, but right in front of me, maybe 10 feet in front of me, was a tripwire with a grenade hanging in a tree like this. It's all in the crotch of a tree. And Tom had seen the tripwire and I had not seen it. And we caught it and we were able to neutralize it. But then we just had, then we had to then go to the thickest jungle to get out because it was the only way we knew with any assurance that we wouldn't have any booby traps.
So we just to think that we were a couple yards away from where friends of ours were killed and maimed and we were wounded, I mean, that's incredible experience. I find it that way, and especially everything was so incredibly real. The smells, the heat, the surrounding jungle and all this, it almost is overpowering for me because it put me right back there.
Less than a month later, the Hagel brothers were wounded again. A Viet Cong mine blew up their armored personnel carrier.
I was on the left side where the major blast came up, and I was burned all up and down the left side of my body and face, and both my eardrums were blown out. So I grabbed Tom first, and he was out, and he had blood coming out of his ears and his nose, and you know, you don't have time to think about is he dead or alive, you just got to get him on the track, but he was totally unconscious, so I threw him out. You know, they bandaged Tom and I up, and then they brought helicopters in and they dusted Tom and I off.
I woke up on a stretcher next to Chuck and a medevac. They medevaced us out of there, and it was at nighttime. And I distinctly remember laying on stretchers with in a helicopter, both of the side doors open with door gunners and that, and it was nighttime.
They patched us back up, and both Tom and I have some loss of hearing, but it's okay. And for about 10 years, I couldn't shave with a regular blade because you're thin, your skin was so thin, I'd have to use regular electric shavers to do it. But, you know, we were lucky. It came out all right.